every time there's an Apple event, like the previous iPad event that announced the new M4 iPad Pro, I try to cover it in multiple ways. Not only am I live posting on social media, images, and information as it comes, but then I try to do a recap video for my YouTube channel, and even did a live stream and recording for the Primary Technology podcast. And I did all of that in just a couple hours after the event ended. So how do I do it? Well, in this video, I'm going to show you all the tools I use, both from capturing images, how I edit my recap video for YouTube incredibly fast, my recording tools for the podcast, and everywhere I distribute it. And the big game of Apple events is coming up as I'm recording this, which is WWDC, so I'll be recapping that as well. And if you want to see all the announcements and new software features coming to iPhone, iPad, and Mac, go ahead and subscribe to the channel right now, because I'll be covering that too. So first up is what I actually do during the event. I'll typically be streaming the event here in a window in Safari on my Mac, and I'm also playing it on my iPad, sometimes a little delayed, just so I can see what's coming up before I want to screenshot it. And that's the first tool I use, which is CleanShot X. The reason why I use it instead of the built-in QuickTime or screenshot tools, I can set up a shortcut that will capture the previous capture area. I have it set here to Option Shift Command D. And whenever I'm covering an event, I'll save those screenshots directly to the desktop and typically create a folder for an event. Now the next thing I'll do is actually capture the area of the video. So you see here it's playing in the YouTube window. I'll capture right inside the video frame so I'm not getting any kind of border, and that'll be the first screenshot. You'll see that CleanShot X screenshot is right here, and I can preview it just to make sure it's exactly what I want captured. Now while I'm watching the event, I could do my keyboard shortcut of Shift Option Command D, and I'm saving screenshots of exactly what's on screen in real time. I never have to think about selecting a specific area or cropping it later. Every time I see an image I want to capture, I just hit my keyboard shortcut, and now I have another image I can share on social media. Now typically I will share them as I go. I try to get 4 images per post because that's the most for Twitter. Threads can do more, but typically I find 4 images is good. And once I share those images, I'll then drag them into that folder. This way I can keep taking screenshots and accessing them right here on the desktop. Now during the event, I also am going to be doing a recap video and podcast, so I need to take notes. For that, I have Bare Notes open right next to my Safari window, and I'm taking all those notes as new products are announced and new features, all the highlights, and this is what I'll refer to back when I do my video recap. And one of the key images I try to capture is this bento box. So there I just did my CleanShot X shortcut, and now I have that screenshot saved to my desktop of all the new features of something like the iPad Air, and I can share that on social media. Then I'll typically have Threads, Mastodon, via the Ivory third-party app, and Twitter all down here in little windows. And when I want to post about something, I'll quickly start a new post. I type something about the iPad Air, whatever it is that was announced, drag the images, and then copy that to my clipboard, and then paste it across all the social media networks, dragging those images in each new post. So that's my process during the event. I'm taking notes, screenshots of the video so I can share it on social media, and then live posting across Threads, Mastodon, and X. But once the event ends, it's time to make that recap video for YouTube. Typically, once an event is over, Apple will have product pages on their website talking about all the new features. So I do try to take a few minutes, even though time is of the essence with those recap videos, and I'll scroll through the new product pages, see if there's any features I missed. And a good place to look is also in the footnotes for each product, because there might be some details that weren't covered during the event. Also go to the tech specs page, because this is a great comparison if there's multiple sizes, like here with the iPad Pro. And you can even compare different model iPads and Macs using Apple's built-in tool. I'll also typically have these websites up when I'm filming my video so I can screen record using CleanShot X and then use those visuals via a multicam clip, which I'll show you in a second, in Final Cut. Once I have all my notes ready, I'll start recording both on my main camera, Sony a7 IV, and I'll start recording my screen using CleanShot X. I'm actually recording right now using CleanShot X and Audio Hijack for audio. You see those little audio meters there. I'll go through all the event information, the recap, the details I have in my note, and I'm also recording that screen while I'm narrating. This way it's going to be easier to edit that later. Once I'm done recording all that footage, I'll import it into Final Cut, and then I have a tool that I use that is key to my entire workflow, both for these live events and literally every video I do for YouTube. And that tool is Gling.ai. I've been using this for many months for all of my YouTube videos, and it saves me hours and hours of time. And I'm really excited because this video is actually sponsored by Gling.ai, because I've already been using them for such a long time. Gling was built specifically for YouTubers, and it works seamlessly in my workflow. Here's a project in Final Cut, and once I've imported my A-roll video from my Sony a7 IV, what I do is I reveal that file in my Finder window, and then I drag it into Gling.ai. I'll title the project, and then what it does is process all the silences and bad takes, and I can go in and see a full transcript of my video, and Gling automatically will delete those bad takes from the video and just save the good ones. Plus, it removes all the silences. This saves me an incredible amount of time editing the A-roll for my video. You can see here all these takes where I was trying to say this one line, Gling automatically cut that out and just left me the last one. Now I can go in and more granularly edit if I want to remove a take there or restore one of the takes that it deleted. And I go through the entire transcript really fast because most of these deletions were automatically done with Gling. And my video is almost edited for me once I'm done here using the Gling app. Then when I export it, I'll use a Final Cut multicam file because I can import that back into Final Cut. And then I have a multicam clip where I'll add my B-roll, my screen grab recording, any other cameras that I had. And once I look at the main project, my A-roll will automatically be cut down precisely how I had it in the Gling app. And then as I go, I can just right click and change my camera angle. And that's basically all I'm doing throughout the video is changing my multicam angle, maybe adding some titles and B-roll over it. And that's how I can edit a video super fast. And I use Gling with all of my YouTube videos, literally every single one. And once you create that multicam clip and bring it back into Final Cut, it's still referencing that raw video file you got off your camera, so you're not losing any quality and nothing is having to be uploaded to the cloud and be brought back down. It all happens here locally on your Mac. Use the link in the video description below to try Gling today and use the coupon code STEPHENROBLES to get an extra free video. My thanks to Gling for sponsoring this video and for just making an incredible tool I use every day. Now, once I'm done editing the video in Final Cut, that goes up on my YouTube channel. I make the thumbnail. I actually capture thumbnail images as screen grabs. So the first maybe 5 minutes of my video file is just me cheesing for the camera. Then I pull that image and I create my thumbnails using Pixelmator. I love Pixelmator for just a ton of reasons. You can quickly remove the background of an image by right-clicking and just remove background. And I do that when I'm layering myself in these thumbnails. This way I can do things like gradients that don't go over my face, and same for when I'm refocusing on the devices. I also use it for all my podcast episode artwork. And that's what comes next. Once my YouTube video is live on the channel, now I'm getting ready to record Primary Technology. We actually did our first live stream during this iPad event, and we recorded and live streamed using Riverside. My co-host Jason was actually at a co-working space up in New York City, and so he tuned in using Riverside. He just had a $50 USB mic, which was great, and his iPhone as continuity camera. And we recorded about an hour podcast. We live streamed that to the YouTube channel using Riverside, but it was also being recorded in high quality because Riverside does both. Once the live stream was over, I created a thumbnail using Pixelmator, and that video was up on the Primary Technology YouTube channel. You should subscribe to that channel too. I'll put a link down in the video description. But then it was time to actually edit the audio version for that podcast. And to do that, I download the raw WAV files from Riverside that was recorded while we were live streaming, and I drag those WAV files using Universal Control over to my iPad because I edit all my podcasts in Ferrite on iPad. Using Ferrite and the Apple Pencil on iPad, I can edit podcasts extremely fast. I listen at 2x speed using the Apple Pencil to make edits, move things around. I add chapters and chapter images all in the Ferrite app. I never have to reprocess it after that. And I can edit almost an hour podcast in about 20 minutes. So I ran through the entire editing process right there on my iPad. Then I export that MP3 file, and that MP3 gets published as a podcast, and I use Transistor.fm to host all the episodes. Plus, Transistor has a really cool feature called Delegated Delivery, so you can actually publish exclusive or bonus content to Apple Podcasts directly from Transistor. I don't even need to log into the Apple Podcasts system. Unless you want to add like an ad-free version to an episode, and then you do have to log in, and processing takes 3 years, but anyway, we won't get into that. But Transistor is what I use to host the audio version of the podcast. And once that's published, that means my video recap is on the channel. We already live streamed, and so that video is on the Primary Technology YouTube channel. And now the audio version is on the RSS feed with Transistor so everyone can listen to the show. And that's everything I did to cover the iPad event and what I do every time. So WWDC is coming up in June. iOS 18, iPadOS 18, new macOS, VisionOS 2.0. If you want to hear about all those updates, I'll be covering it live, both on social media, and then a recap video on my YouTube channel, and a live broadcast for Primary Technology. So subscribe and follow along if you want all those updates. Plus, I'll do one of those top features of iOS 18 and top features of tvOS 18 once we get the betas at WWDC. So if you have any questions, leave comments below this video about my process, gear, or anything like that. And if you want to see my recent review of the M4 iPad Pro, I'll put that video right up here. Or if you want a more behind the scenes of maybe how I built this studio, which is about 2 years old and I got to really customize it how I want, I'll put that video right up here. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you next time.